Please rise as you are comfortable and join me in this call to worship. People of God, welcome. Surely God is in this place.
We come to worship and to rest in God's presence.
Breathe deep, for the goodness of God surrounds us.
The Holy One who sustains the universe is near.
When we are tired, worn down and carrying heavy burdens, God is with us.
God strengthens us that we might carry one another's burdens.
So let us join together in wonder and thanksgiving for God's love that lifts us up on wings like eagles. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's join together in our praise. Oh God, we are gathered here under the shelter of your wings, nurtured by your motherly love, and encouraged then to fly by faith on the wind of your Spirit. You have spoken to us, saying that they wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. Teach us this morning how to wait then, that we may learn how to fly. May this nest we call one another be built with sturdy materials. And don't let us forget, though, that this nest was not created as a fortress behind which to hide, but as a perch from which to take off. Strengthen us with the assurance that we do not fly alone. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I invite you, if you're comfortable, to stand and greet each other with the peace of Christ. Return to your seats. I always find that this time could be padded. I mean, I would visit with every single one of you had I had the time. If you have not already done so, please fill in the attendance pads at the end of each row. Some people wonder, why do we do this, Pastor? You are living into the uniqueness of being United Methodists. Did you know we are required to report our attendance to our conference every year? We can't do that if we don't know who was here with us. And so we have some good oddities, like we're really good with hosting potlucks and acting out of our faith into movements of social justice. One of the other quirks is that we do have to check attendance each week, and so please do so, and don't fail to do so. We'll be introducing some different ways to do so in the coming weeks ahead. Some of you participated last week in our worship survey. This is really important for us, as the worship committee will now be getting together and reviewing your feedback. This is still available at the back table, just outside the center doors. If you did not have a chance, from what I have seen submitted, very interestingly, I mean, I won't ask you to raise your hands, but in your mind, do we prefer hymns or praise songs? You're like, oh, well, we're 138 years old church. We probably like tradition. The statistics say that. Of the hymns that were given to you to select, the people who gave their feedback only voted for 40% of the hymns, meaning 60% of the hymns were not very meaningful, whereas 45% of the praise songs were found to be meaningful. I thought that was quite interesting of an observation. We will continue to collect these. You have a new survey today. It's called Worship Preference for Ash Wednesday, Holy Week, and Easter. Did you know some people have asked me on Christmas Eve why we don't have a late night service for candlelighting on Christmas Eve? And when I ask, will you be there? Oh no, Pastor, I don't drive at night. It's hard for me as a pastor to organize our gatherings when I hear mixed messages. And so I'm asking you to fill this survey out so that we know, that I know, as we plan, we are trying to meet the most needs that we can. I know we can't meet everyone's needs, but surely we can try to meet the most needs. And so please fill it out. It asks, for instance, what time would you prefer to gather for Ash Wednesday? 8 a.m., 12 at noon, 7 p.m., other, or I'm not planning to attend at all. That's fine. I need to know. There are other questions there. Please fill them out, and please don't leave today until you fill this out so that we can make those arrangements. These forms are at the same table behind you. You can make use of the fellowship time to do so. We'll move the basket over to fellowship hour at the end. We are transitioning our services, beginning the Lenten season. The 8 o'clock Zoom service will join us here in our live, in the in-person service via live stream. If you and your family members make use of our 8 o'clock service, know that the 8 o'clock gathering will continue in a fellowship format, but the message for Sundays will be presented here. Also beginning in the Lenten season, there are those of you who serve in various ways, either by preparing our social hour or assisting in our Sunday school program, who don't get a chance to visit or to worship on Sundays as you would as a participant. And so beginning the Sunday in the Lenten season, we will be hosting a separate Zoom gathering for those leaders where I will share the message on Sunday mornings, and we will also have the opportunity to share among those who had served about how their service went. This, again, is a way to provide alternative ways for you to gather and to make use of the time that we have together. We are also being very intentional to make our services more inclusive during that same period. You'll hear from our All Abilities Ministries at our mission moment in just a second. There was one other announcement that I wanted to make. A few weeks ago, I found that on the church credit card, there was a fraudulent activity. And so I notified our bank, and they were able to track it down, and they had to cancel the card. In doing so, it canceled a lot of the accounts that the card was attached to, one of which was our website. I don't know if you've noticed, some of you may have noticed yesterday and the day before, our website was down. It's been restored. It just takes time for their service to catch up. And so hopefully you would see that it's working. Were you able to find your bulletins online this morning as you came in? So it is working. So thank you for your understanding. I want to give our attention now to our All Abilities moment.
Had to make some adjustments. Okay. All Abilities Ministry began its mission to reach the special needs community a little over 6 months ago. Many of us among the congregation are curious as to what has been done to put God's love into action for a special needs community so far.
Has used the first half of our grant time to build in those practical pieces. Those practical pieces needed in order to ensure a strong foundation for an accommodating space for those who have special needs. Our Board of Trustees have identified the ways our church building can be made more accessible to the disability community. Our folks in charge of finance have identified the ways our church can utilize the funding from the grant to increase a higher level of accessibility for those with special need. Our ministry design team has helped to create ways of moving forward in this ministry in a variety of ways. With the help of these committees and several teams, we've been able to purchase additional automatic door openers and create further disability seating areas in the back two sections of our sanctuary. The congregation has delivered two outreach events, the Fall Festival and Sensitive Santa. The church has created digital spaces where some of the special need community can connect in worship and fellowship. And with the help of our SPED Ed community and the autism community, All Abilities Ministry was able to purchase the supportive and adaptive equipment needed for this particular population. You know those yoga balls, those trampolines, the strange-looking swings? They all have specific purposes for the special needs community. And soon we will have time to dialogue for those who are curious to come and learn a little bit more about that.
That all sounds great, but many are curious about how the first 6 months of this grant has impacted our church. I'll ask you, the congregation, some questions and have you raise your hands to answer. Ready? Are you guys ready?
Yes.
Got to raise your hand or stand up or however you feel to do this. How many of you have used the automatic doors and found them to be helpful raise your hand or stand up. Okay. How many of you have had a loved one use the trampoline, swings, or quiet areas to self-regulate while at church? Raise your hand. How many folks have seen others use the trampoline, swings, quiet areas, and yoga balls? Raise your hand. And keep them up if you can. I know that gets a little tiring.
Is that everybody who has raised their hand? Hands back up. Okay, let's go.
How many folks have accessed church digitally? How many of you know someone who likely will need to access the church primarily through digital means? Raise your hands. How many of you, as you age, will likely find the automatic doors, the disability seating, and raise awareness of disability to be helpful for you in the future in this church? Oh, that's a lot more. Yeah.
Well, Laura, it sure does appear that some of you out here have already experienced some of the impact from All Abilities Ministry, as Laura has demonstrated. But borrowing from Pastor's analogy of the garden a few weeks ago, some of us here are daisies and some are violets. Just as each of us are adorned with God's given gifts and talents, each of us here also have need. And as we age, our needs will change. Some of our needs may fall in a category of typical needs, and some of our needs may fall under special needs that may require a little difference in accommodation than others. And when that happens, I believe that each of you will still need the proclamation of the good news of Jesus Christ. Rather than becoming one who used to go to church, who longs to go to church, imagine still having a seat among this congregation made possible for you in order to be here so that you can continue to receive the good news of Jesus. Friends, is there any greater gift than the good news of Jesus Christ? And is there any greater love to share than the love of Christ? Among the families already in our congregation with developmental challenges and disability, each of our families have reported feeling supported in the alternative spaces that you all created. From the Fall Festival, Sensitive Santa, and the Super Saturdays alone, you have shared the Christ-like love with over a dozen families challenged by developmental disability who otherwise could not have been here among us. You should applaud yourselves for that. Good job. Folks, the Foundation for Evangelism entrusted this church with this grant in order to reach the special need community with the good news of Jesus Christ. And you, church, have indeed done so. With gratitude, the recipients of All Abilities Ministry thank you for sharing the love of Jesus and putting God's love into action for them. In fact, I have something to share with you along with an exercise to help us connect with the good work that has been done here. Do you remember when we used to paint rocks in Ross Hall and we would talk about leaving those rocks with little messages for folks as they came? Well, Fall Festival and Sensitive Santa gave us the opportunity to put those rocks out. And every single one of them were taken. They all have the message of love and scriptures written and, you know, letting folks know how much God loves them. And in return, we had rocks that were left for us. Rocks that said, thank you, Tempe First, for doing this for us. I brought four of them, one for each of these sections. I'd like to hand one off to you, and if you would, place it in your hands and say a small prayer for this ministry, and then pass it on.
Has it been fun? Well, we have more fun coming. It's now time to plan for the sensory-friendly bunny event. There'll be a congregation-wide meeting in Ross Hall at 11 o'clock. Please join us as we plan another fun event that puts God's love into action for the special needs community. Thank you.
Today's scripture reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21 to 31, and Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 39. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see, who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and assert, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick and possessed by demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place. And there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout all Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons.
Okay. Let me see your hands. Wait. Let me see. They work? They all work? Clap them? Shake hands with each other? Yeah? Yeah, shake hands with Hyacinth. Your hands work? Yeah, you can do that too. Okay. Everybody stand up. Move your feet around. Do your feet work? Yeah? Yeah? I want you to go give these away. Give these, just go out there.
I don't have them for everybody. Go give them to somebody. Give them, go out there and give them away. Go, give them away. Go out there and give them away. Here's another one. Quick, give them away and then come back. You want to see one? Yep, here. Go give it away. Good job, Olivia. Give it to somebody and come back. Don't forget to come back. Okay. Oh, well, that's good. You know what I like? Not one of you said, but I want to keep it. Oh, she kept it. Oh, well. So she's just a baby. She's learning it. So last week when you were working on your, when we were talking and you were working on your maze, we kept saying, do justice, love kindness, walk with God. Okay. And that comes, do you remember who that, what that book was? Micah. Remember that? We wrote that, Micah. Yeah. So some ways to think of that are when we say do justice, that means do what's right. Use your hands to do the right thing. Okay? The next part of it is love kindness or be kind. Use your heart to love others. And the last part is walk with God. So use your feet to walk with God and do the right things. Okay? So say it after me again. Say, do justice, love kindness, walk with God.
And walk with God.
We have been looking at becoming the people of God during this season of Epiphany. At first, we looked at the baptism of Christ and renewed our baptismal vows. And then we took a number of weeks to examine the call of God and our faithful response, both as leaders serving in this community of faith and as disciples of Christ seeking to serve the communities that are connected with us. We considered how being the people of God is more than just being a part of a family, but a faith community that intentionally seeks to connect with others. Today, our reading in Isaiah and Mark concludes our focus on becoming the people of God by addressing a key act of faith, waiting. Do you find yourself waiting? Perhaps you're waiting for an answer or waiting for healing to occur, waiting for your dream to unfold. It's a complex matter as people of faith. We pray to God for help, for God's guidance, and for God's leading. When it doesn't happen, we become weary, restless. We yearn for God to respond. I should first claim that in Christian faith, we have carried this notion about waiting for the Lord. We say spiritual truth, one-liners like, God's timing is perfect, so we wait for the Lord. And we sing songs like, He makes all things beautiful in His time. And believing these to be true, we wait for the Lord patiently, and yes, sometimes restlessly. About a year ago this time, I was deep in wrestling with CSR, central serous retinopathy. The vision impairment had begun the year before in September. And my visit to the ophthalmologist said that there was a chance that my vision impairment would go away on its own in a few months or so. Well, it had been more than 4 months at that point, but my eyesight had not improved at all. I was waiting for healing and waiting and praying and sharing and praying and waiting for healing, but it did not come. Trying to read, type, became an increasingly frustrating task because I could not get through the same amount of work, though the expectation of the work had not changed. Hiking was a challenge. I could not gauge the depth of my steps. And though I had made plans to go on leave, I had voiced my concerns to the Lilly implementation team that if my vision did not return, I would have to change my plans substantially. There was no hope for me to hike Fuji if I could not be confident in my steps. And so I know from personal experience, waiting can be painful, and it's not just in the body, but in the mind and spirit. It is for many a miserable time. Perhaps that is where you find yourself this morning. Perhaps in prospects for new work. Perhaps because of a deteriorating relationship. Perhaps because of a treatment that has not yet come. I see you and feel you. And yet this morning, our scripture reading offers us a different perspective, a fresh interpretation, a shift from the passive ache of waiting for the Lord to the active embrace of waiting with the Lord. Now, Isaiah's words that we read in the 31st verse is usually translated in the English language as, "Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." Yes, it says clearly, "Those who wait for the Lord." But you know, the Hebrew language in which the scriptures were written, well, their language and grammar does not convey expressions like we do in the English language. They are an arrangement of keywords and ideas that appear together in succession. And so it's up to the reader to extrapolate the relationship. Let me give you an example. In Genesis, when God created the creatures in the oceans and on the land, well, that verse, it says, Elohim ra'a ki tov. Elohim, our God, ra'a, saw. He, which is that or which, and tov, good. So you basically just have four words. God saw that good. How do we translate those words into English? And God saw that it was good. Do you see? There are words in English that don't appear in the Hebrew. Well, the same is occurring in Isaiah 40, verse 31. The Hebrew language simply says, Ka'a Yehovah, which is the verb Ka'a, wait, look, hope, expect, and the proper noun, Yehovah, Jehovah. And from that, we have the translation, those who wait for the Lord, but it can also be interpreted, those who wait with the Lord. And the difference it for me suggests that waiting for the Lord, well, that's a passive approach. It's a posturing of ourselves, sidelining until God does something in our midst. It's like waiting for the rain to stop or for the bus to arrive. There's nothing more for us to do than to simply pass the time until God's perfect time arrives. Now, there's nothing inherently wrong with that kind of waiting, only I believe there is more that God is inviting us to do. Even as we wait for something to take action, we always have the opportunity to engage with God in it. To wait not for the Lord, but to wait with the Lord. Engaging with God in the waiting, it's an active waiting. It's like guards on the watchtower. They're not simply standing on guard. They are actively watching the horizon, seeking for signs. Waiting with God is an active waiting. I think the imagery that the prophet Isaiah uses of the eagle makes this even more convincing. Think of the mighty eagle perched on a peak looking below. Does it simply wait for the prey to fall on its lap? No. It spreads its wings, scans the horizon, and prepares for flight. Its wait is not passive, but it's filled with focused anticipation, ready to soar the moment opportunity arises. And this, my friends, is the essence of waiting with the Lord, not about idly twiddling thumbs, expecting God to magically solve our problems. It's about actively engaging, tuning our hearts to God's presence, strengthening our faith as the eagle preens its feathers. I mean, the scripture in verse 31 continues later on saying, they shall mount up with wings like eagles. It's with wings, not on wings, that has become so popular in phrases, perhaps because of the famous Christian song. It's about, being on eagle's wings. You know, I can't help but think about the Lord of the Rings again, when they fly back from Mount Mordor on eagles. It's a passive approach. You just enjoy the ride. But that's not what it says. It says, with wings. You have wings. You are granted wings. And so it suggests movement, work, activity. And there is a difference. Recall the story of Sarah and Abraham. They have been given the promise from the Lord that they would have a child of their own, but they waited decades for this promised child, and their hearts heavy with longing. But did they despair and wallow? Did they wallow in despair? No. They continued their journey. They built altars. They remained in their faith, and they walked with God, even in their long shadows of doubt. Their wait wasn't passive. It was a pilgrimage of trust and perseverance. I think of the disciples after Jesus' ascension. They didn't simply just wait around waiting for Christ to return. They actively preached, engaged their community, strengthened it, prepared for the coming of the Holy Spirit. Their wait wasn't idle either. It was a period of service and spiritual growth. Waiting with the Lord isn't about getting what we want. It's about becoming who we need to be. I think about the story presented here in Mark about both the illness that Simon Peter's mother-in-law was facing and also those who were sick in the crowd. It says that Jesus and his disciples were returning from the synagogue. It must have been mid-morning by then. And I think we can safely assume that Peter's mother-in-law must have had this fever for a while now, certainly since the morning. Otherwise, why the urgency in their voice? They immediately told Jesus. And yet, they didn't tell Jesus. I mean, Peter, who must have known about this, didn't tell Jesus first thing in the morning. He waited for Jesus to finish his rabbinic duties at the synagogue. Peter wasn't just home waiting for Jesus to return. He joined with Jesus, engaged with him, even in the waiting. I think about the crowd who gathered, asking and wanting, who were drawn to Jesus, seeking healing. I mean, they came, all who were sick and possessed by demon-possessed. Can you sense their urgency? I mean, have any of you been a caretaker? And how exasperating that is, how you would do anything to relieve your loved one's pain or discomfort. You don't want any of that to go for longer than it needs to be. What about those who brought forth those loved ones with who were demon-possessed? That's a harder one for us to put in context. But let's imagine that it's people with erratic behavior. Perhaps they are mentally unstable. Perhaps it's like someone who is under the influence of narcotics. You can then begin to sense their urgency as well. They're seeking healing. All of them are seeking her healing, and it's an urgent matter. But as evening approached, some of them returned home. They missed that opportunity. At least that's my interpretation, because in the Gospel of Mark, the very next morning, there's yet another crowd that had gathered. And so, even there, I see a people who are actively waiting, seeking Christ, not just yearning for healing, but actively moving, waiting for their turn, waiting with hope to experience the healing to come, to experience for themselves an encounter with Jesus Christ. Before I forget, there's a workshop that is a free workshop that is being made available at Cross in the Desert United Methodist Church for caretakers. There will be a printout available in the office after worship. It's this Saturday, free breakfast and lunch if you want to go. But anyone who is in the position of being a caretaker, it would be a good opportunity to find some community. Now, I want to be clear. I believe in healing. I have experienced it. I have experienced and I believe in healing that occurs in the supernatural and also in the most natural ways. I mean, supernatural healing sometimes takes the spotlight. It's always fascinating to hear someone's experience of it. But even so, even when my body recovers from the simple cold or flu, it never fails to amaze me how God has created our bodies to do that. I also believe that not all healing is physical. And not to say the obvious, but you know, our bodies, they not only can, but tend to break again. We bleed again. And to me, perhaps physical healing doesn't deserve the high status it gets in our society or from a medical standpoint. Healing can be emotional. Often, it is spiritual healing that we seek more than anything. You should know that the University of California, they pump millions of dollars in their health system to provide spiritual care because they recognize the importance and the significance of spiritual healing that accompanies their patients. As for me, with my vision still compromised, ultimately, I began to shift my expectations. I learned to accept that perhaps the vision impairment was going to be permanent, and I chose intentionally to give thanks that I had at least one good eye. Admittedly, I was reluctant to claim that at first. But as I leaned more into this by faith, I began to live with a greater sense of peace. And I also began to notice just how challenging it is to live with a disability to begin with, and also the gifts and challenges that accompany those who live with a hidden disability. It's why I affirmed wholeheartedly the opportunity to be in ministry with people of all abilities. And I did speak about my experience to some extent. Last year, I've come to rely on your support in the community. I discovered so many in our congregation who also are challenged with vision. And in God's time, and indeed through your prayers, I eventually did recover from it. My vision had returned, and no, it was not as great as it once was, but honestly, I couldn't notice the difference, as unbelievable as that may seem. I mean, I still have to, you know, close the good eye to check, oh yeah, it is still a little, I just don't notice it anymore. I thank God for the healing, but I appreciate more the deeper understanding of God, of God's people, and our relationship with God that experience had provided. Waiting with the Lord can also be for you a time to deepen your faith, to deepen your prayer life. And so I encourage you to pray, not just about your desires, not about, but also about your fears, your hopes, your very being. Let your prayers be a conversation with God, with pauses and moments of deep connection, and not just a checklist of things to say. Waiting with the Lord can be a time for you to study and reflect, and I encourage you to immerse yourself in Scripture, to seek wisdom from others, and ponder the mysteries of faith. Let it be a time of intellectual and spiritual exploration. Waiting with the Lord can also be a time for you to serve others. And I encourage you to look beyond your own needs and reach out to those in need. Let the wait be a time of compassion and action. In all, just remember, wait is not wasted time. It's fertile ground for growth. Consider the wait like the period after the rain, when the ground is moist. You can't run outside and play ball. It's just too muddy for that. And that is indeed a bummer, my children remind me. But it's a great time to pull the weeds out from a soil that is now soft. Or shall I say, a more sensitive, malleable spirit that is now in you. And in fact, if you just stand idly by waiting for the ground to dry up so that you can play ball, well, those weeds that were also there will have only grown bigger, its roots just that much more deeper. Whatever I say this morning, though, I also want to recognize that there is at times waiting that is just too much to bear. When there are too many variables outside of your control to do anything about, when you're left at the mercy of others, when there's just nothing left in you to do anything. Trust. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him and He will make your paths straight. The wise saying that we find in Proverbs chapter 3. A couple of days ago, while staring up into the blue sky, I noticed a large bird, and I'm sorry, my knowledge of birds is not good enough for me to be able to distinguish apart a hawk from a falcon from an eagle, but that is the first thing that came to my mind, an eagle. Its wings were open, and it was calm, hovering there almost. It made large circles, and it slowly drifted northward where the wind was blowing it. And that image is like also an image of waiting with the Lord. It's still waiting. It's active waiting, just not with much action. It's like the eagle actively leaning into the wind. Lean into the Spirit. Becoming the people of God will almost always require you at some point in your life, in your journey, perhaps this week, maybe even this day, to endure some form of waiting in faith. When we shift our perspective, waiting then becomes not a burden, but an opportunity. Let us choose to wait with the Lord, spreading our wings of faith, ready to soar with wings like eagles when the time comes. And together in the wait, may we find strength, hope, and expect great things that are yet to come. Amen. Join me in a moment of prayer. O Lord, it is in you that we trust. You know where we are, how we've gotten here. You also lead us to where we are to go. As we wait for you, allow and help us to wait with you, to engage with you, to dwell deeper in your presence, so that we might be better aligned to your Son, Jesus Christ. This morning, Lord, we lift up prayers, especially for those seeking healing in body and in spirit. We know you to be life giver and life sustainer. As you have our trust, be our Lord and provide life and restoration and well-being in your people. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We gather today at the Great Thanksgiving, and so if it's meaningful for you, you can open the hymn to follow along in our liturgy. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for the day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so, with their people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. Take, eat. Do this in remembrance of me for the forgiveness of sins. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
May the service come forward.
You are welcome to join. Our communion is open and available to all. We have gluten-free elements and individual elements as you request. Come, the table is open.
Thank you.
Will you join me in prayer? Lord, we had feasted at your table, and as you have nourished us, may we go into your world to bring a feast of peace and hope to others. In the name of our Savior, amen. In thanksgiving for this and all the ways that God's grace is made aware in our lives, let us come now to offer our gifts. God of power and patience, we gather in worship to wait for your presence to be filled with your power. Jesus healed with a touch and taught us that you are the source of true healing that can make us whole. And so, as we take time now in worship to offer our gifts to you, we pray that they might be used to bring healing of body, of spirit, of broken relationship, healing of a planet that is groaning, healing of a world community that is deeply divided by distrust and self-interest. Bring this healing, O Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite you, as you're comfortable, to join now in our hymn of commitment. Now to wait with God, to pay attention to all God is doing around you, and to serve as the Spirit guides you. And may the peace of Christ bless you and keep you wherever you may go. Amen.
God be with you till we meet again. God is now so far. Thanks, Brian. Good music. Thanks.